The opinions expressed in this show are the views of the host and not necessarily that of WTRW, 94.3 The Talker, or the Bold Gold Media Group.
The following presentation is brought to you by the host of the program, who is solely responsible for its content.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Make a Change. I'm your host, Terry Martin, along with my producer, Tom Jenkins.
Good afternoon, Terry. How are you?
Very good. And good afternoon to you, Tom.
You did it again.
What did I do?
You surprised me. You have a nice woman here with you. And I asked Terry, I said, well, what are we talking about? She goes, it's just going to be fantastic. We'll let you listen. So I have no idea what we're doing again today. And you do this to me often, which I appreciate, though. I do like it.
I find out surprises throughout the show, even the things that we talk about on the interview ahead of time. I'm just very inspired. But Tom, today our special guest is Mary Kay Martin, and her story is very inspiring. And I don't want to give too much away.
You said that to me already.
But what I can tell you is this is going to be one very exciting hour.
And this is Make a Change on 94.3 FM, The Talker. It's a show all about making changes, whether it be financial changes, whether it be emotional changes, whether it be spiritual changes. We even had Rob Crane from the Scranton-Wilkes-Barre Rail Riders in here for family changes, different things you can do in every aspect of your life. What Terry tries to do with this show is to help you make a change in your life, or at least a beginning to make the change. And I can't wait to hear what Mary Kay is all about.
And speaking of changes, Mary Kay said that yes, there are some changes you can control, but there are some that you can't control.
Mm-hmm.
And so some of the story is going to be a little painful at times to hear. Mm. However, we just need to follow the story and hear where her path leads and why she does what she does to help others. Everything Mary Kay has to talk about has to do, as you said earlier, with make a change, because she surely has made many changes in her life so far. And she has come above all kinds of obstacles, but those hardships are what she is about to share with us. And that's in the hope to help others and our listeners. And that is why Mary Kay drove back from New Jersey to come to Scranton.
And the reason why Terry is overemphasizing that is because we gave her a hard time before the show because she was saying Scranton.
I'll have to remember that. Because this is Mary Kay's hometown, and this is, of course, where she grew up. And so that's why we wanted her to be on the show, and she wanted to be on the show today.
Well, thank you so much for making the trek again, and thank you so much for being on the show today. We really appreciate it.
No problem.
And she was telling me about the good old days, and I thought maybe some people might enjoy strolling down memory lane for a short while with her. So, Mary Kay, would you like to begin telling us about that train station?
Oh, the Radisson. Now, at one point, it was the Erie, well, started off as the Delaware Lackawanna, and then it turned into the Erie Lackawanna. And actually, my first memory is at the train station waiting on the platform with my dad from my grandmother's youngest sister, Aunt Aggie, to come in from Buffalo. And the steam engines were chugging, you know, came chugging in and the whole routine. Now it's the Tracks restaurant. So I'd love to go back there and just sit and look around. And it's very nostalgic. And at the point, I had a cousin also that worked at the Erie Lackawanna. And at that time, there were offices.
Where the hotel rooms are now.
Oh. Yeah, as a matter of fact, one time I just went there and I just rode up on the elevator just to look around and see what it looked like, because I basically had seen it from the outside when I was growing up. But she used to come, she'd have dinner with us on Wednesday night, and it was like a big deal because she brought dessert, and it was always a really good dessert. So that's what I, they are the things that I remember about the Radisson.
But you say you grew up in North Scranton.
Yes, I did.
And you had a beautiful house then, and yeah. To come back now.
I don't go past it anymore, because the last time I was past, it was very depressing to see. I think we talked about you can't go home again.
Right.
You might like to, but you really can't, because things change
right,
so
it'll
much.
It'll never be the same.
No, it never will be. No, it never will. But things are what they are, and things move on.
And we were even discussing your maiden name, because you maybe people listening to this show are people you went to school with, and I thought maybe you would want to mention what your maiden name was.
My maiden name was, or, well, actually, it is.
That's one of those things you can't change.
That's right. I can't change it. I actually wouldn't want to. It's Hitzel. And actually, maybe some people that I went to school with might know me, but they also might recognize the name of Hitzel because my dad was a teacher at West Scranton High School for many, many years. As a matter of fact, he retired from there. I don't remember what year it was exactly, but he did retire as a teacher from West Scranton High School.
And then you followed in his footsteps and went to Marywood, right?
I went to Marywood. At that time, it was a college. It wasn't the university.
That's
it was
my
Marywood
alma mater.
College. Is it really?
And that's where I went. It was still a college when I went, too.
That's right. Uh-huh. Well, I don't feel so old then.
Now, when I went, it was co-ed, but at one point, it was all women, I believe.
Oh, yeah, that's when I went. It was all women. It was
all women. Stories are good about that.
Well, it was back in the late 50s, and I graduated in 61. Do the math. I'm old. But anyway.
But wise.
We had the whole lifestyle was so different then. When I went to Marywood, of course, it was all girls. When we were allowed to wear bobby socks, but if we were going to wear them to school, we had to wear stockings under them. We could wear our sneakers with our bobby socks, but the stockings had to be on us. Otherwise, I don't know what the nuns would have done because I was always too afraid not to do what I was told. And I can remember I majored in, well, it actually was foods and nutrition, which is basically home economics, but I don't think they call that that anymore. I think what it's now consumer science is what it's called now. But anyway, back then it was called home economics. And there were certain days of the week when we would have to dress professionally. They wanted to get us trained to make sure that we knew how to dress when we got jobs. And we would go with our heels and our stockings and
our
good
dresses. Boy, are we missing that now?
Yeah, we are. But
I'm sorry.
In a way, it's a little easier now because trying to figure out what clothes you're going to wear and everything else and make sure that you look as good as everybody else or if you're really... maybe sometimes a little better.
Yeah.
You're not so focused on that. You can just be more relaxed.
But we've lost our class. I mean, that was a period of time when beauty, you know, now a lot of women are we just wear those jogging outfits even to the supermarket.
True.
Or pajamas.
Pajamas, yes.
You see that a lot.
But I'm amazed. That amazes me. I mean, the jogging outfits, okay. Pajamas? I kind of think, things really have changed. Have I gotten that old?
You know, I was in the produce department, and a man that worked there, he came up to me and he said, you know what, I'm not trying to flirt. I am not trying to hit on you or anything. He said, it's just so nice to see a woman in a dress. I think men would love it if we would go back to, well, maybe it's just a figment of my imagination that that's the way it should be. But it was a pretty time.
It was a pretty time.
It was classy.
Yeah. And I mean, even when we would get dressed, we would get dressed up on Saturdays and we'd go to town. There were no malls at the time. And there was the dry goods and the Globe store. They were the two big stores, big department stores.
I remember that.
You would get dressed. You would wear the heels and the stockings and the gloves and the hats and the whole thing. And you wouldn't even think of going any place not dressed like that. As a matter of fact, there was a time when I would want to wear, we used to call them dungarees, or now they're jeans. My father would not let me out of the house in pants. I could not wear my dungarees anywhere but in the house.
Let alone the nuns.
Oh,
telling
good grief, the nuns would
could not wear that to school.
God bless them. They would not tolerate that.
Well, looking back, and we're talking about all of the good old days. Let's start talking about when the not so good old days started. And you ended up marrying, and I'll let you take it from that point.
Okay. Yes, I did wind up marrying someone. I was 27 years old, so I should have known better. But then who does? We were married it was 1967, and we moved outside of Wilkes-Barre. It was an abusive relationship, and it is a little hard for me to talk about, so I may be hesitating, or you may hear a little tremor in my voice, but anyhow, this is pretty much the way it went. It started off, the abuse started off, you'd think it was simple. It was a slap on the rear end. And I believed that I deserved it because I had said something that made him angry. And that was just the first step. And things were not too bad until after his dad died. And I had my first child, and I remember she was 5 months old. And then it was the pushing and the shoving and the wanting to control. One of the things was I could not take the car out of the house because he didn't want me to. And when he would come home from work, the first thing he would do was check the hood of the car to make sure it wasn't warm. And he also had the car parked in tire tracks. And the car had to be in those exact tracks. Otherwise, you know, get out of town because the consequences were horrendous. I was fortunate in having a friend who used to pick me up and we'd go places and do things and I'd get back before he'd get home from work.
That was bravery.
Well, that's how I got around that one. But things escalated, and I actually have 6 kids. And it wasn't, there was nothing about domestic abuse or domestic violence until after I'd had my six children. And I remember with my youngest one, I watched a lot of TV because I was giving them a bottle, and it was kind of boring just to sit there. And it was a Phil Donahue show that came on, and they were talking about abusive relationships, and I had to turn it off because it was hitting so close to home. Of course, I didn't see myself as being abused. I didn't see myself as a victim. So, but it was hurting me because I was thinking, oh, this is so awful, this is so horrible, and I had to turn it off. But it, in retrospect, I know it was because it was hitting a nerve in my one of my nerves. But anyhow, to get back to the abuse, it did escalate. It went from the slapping to the shoving, and then it went to the actual beatings. And there were a few times when he wanted to kill me. The one time that I remember very distinctly was he was bashing my head against a door. I don't remember what started it or what escalated it or anything to this point, but he told me he was going to get a gun and shoot me. I had thrown all the bullets out, so I knew he couldn't shoot me, but he went to get this gun. He was a hunter, and he had a lot of guns. There was no question about that. And anyway, he went, and I don't know what happened, but he seemed to have calmed down between the time he left me after having bashed the head against the door and gone into the bedroom to get a gun. But something happened and he calmed down. But what happened was the kids were in the living room.
That's the problem.
That was a huge problem. And so you don't think that kids internalize this stuff, but believe me, they do. The next day I was at work and I got a call that my youngest daughter, who was 6 at the time, she had a very bad stomach ache, and that they needed me to come and pick her up. And I went and I picked her up and I brought her home. And I remember she sat in my lap and I said to her, "Is something bothering you?" And she looked at me and she said, "Mommy, I'm afraid he's going to kill you."
Yeah.
I calmed her down and I said, "Your daddy couldn't possibly kill me. He just talks a lot and he threatens." But I think...
But he did try to even choke you after that, correct?
He did. This was a few years later. He did. I was working. And I weighed over 200 pounds, but he decided I was having an affair. I don't know who was supposed to have had the affair with me or who I would even... I mean, he didn't know me very well because that was something that was so totally out of anything I would ever do, no matter what I looked like. But I was 200 pounds. And he accused me of having an affair. And I was totally bewildered about, you know, like, why would you say this to me? I mean, this is the most... I didn't say it was the most ridiculous thing, because if I said that, I would have gotten a black eye. But... I tried to find out what it was that was bothering him. And he said that we had been at a St. Patrick's Day party with my brother and sister-in-law. And there was this gentleman who was there who was a judge. And I was talking to him. He sat next to me. And it was an interesting conversation. So I saw the man once in my life. Never saw him before. To this day, I haven't seen him again. And he decided that he was the one I was having the affair with. And then the other thing was, we had been at a party, and there was a younger guy who kind of was following me around. And I would go to him and I'd say, you know, come on, get away. Let me get away from this guy. I mean, keep him away from me. I'm uncomfortable with this. But that was one of the other reasons he decided I was having an affair. And it made absolutely no sense whatsoever. But at that point, he put his hands around my neck and started to choke me. I knew that if I moved one muscle in my face, I was dead. And the one thing that was going through my head was, what a horrible thing for my children to have to put up with knowing that their father murdered their mother. Mm-hmm. And I have no idea what happened, but somehow or another, I just got completely out of myself. It was like I was up on the wall looking down. And I stayed as calm as I possibly could. I didn't say a word. I didn't move a muscle. And the pressure was on my neck. And was yelling and screaming in my face. And then whatever it was, he got through with, and he stopped.
Now, did your children see that too?
They didn't see it, but again, they were in the house.
Right, don't think they did, but they probably were looking around the corner. Actually, my hands are sweating. My palms are just wet.
Yeah, well, this is a great spot to take a quick little break.
Okay.
So we will take a little bit of a break. You're listening to Make a Change on 94.3 FM, The Talker. Confidence. It's something we all search for. It's something we all strive for. When we're confident, we feel we can accomplish anything. I mean, think about it. When you knew you looked good, you walked with your head held a little higher. Looking people in the eye was easy. You felt like you could tackle the world. The first step in finding that confidence is obviously how you look. And when you look good on the outside, you feel good on the inside. Get that confidence you need with Mederi Clinicals. They are a unique skincare company that specializes in complete skincare for women and men, from anti-aging to glycolic and even a special clinical line for sensitive skin. Mederi Clinicals gives you that confidence. Make that change. Look brand new. Feel brand new with Mederi Clinicals. Check out MederiClinicals.com. That's MederiClinicals.com, or call 866-646-3374. Take on the world with Mederi Clinicals.
Welcome back to Make a Change on 94.3 FM, The Talker. Today, before we took the break, we were talking to Mary Kay about abuse. And we're going to have her go back to where she was saying that she actually felt like a pretzel twisting in every way to... Wait, I'm not going to explain it.
Okay.
I'll let you.
Well, every time that one of these incidents would happen, I always listened to him tell me how I had caused it. And I wasn't a good wife, and I wasn't good at anything. And I was, everything, all the input was negative. So believing him, as I did, because it was the only input I had, I was pretty isolated, I tried to change. And I quite literally, as I told Terry, twisted myself into a pretzel trying to be what he wanted me to be. I eventually did realize that there was nothing that I could do to be what he wanted me to be, because it was not possible to be that kind of a perfect person.
And you lost your confidence.
I lost it completely.
And the whole thing is that here you were, an educated school teacher. Education has nothing to do with this kind of abuse. Anybody can be abused. It doesn't matter your profession. It doesn't
Absolutely.
Have anything to do with it.
It has nothing to do with intelligence.
And I think that's a big reason why we're talking about this today, is that hopefully this could actually help someone. Because I remember at one point you had said, Mary Kay, you were sitting there with your child watching Phil Donahue.
That's right.
And it was almost like a subtle sign. It's like, no, you can get help, but you had to shut it off. You didn't notice that was... That's where you can get some help now.
Yeah.
So that's why we're doing what we're doing here today. Mm-hmm. And again, thank you so much for coming in to do this today.
Yeah, it's painful.
It is. It is. It is. Going back to that era time in my life it's very emotional.
But then at one point, you decided you needed, I guess there was no victim's resource available at that time.
No.
But you went to try to get help?
Yeah, well.
To an attorney?
It was just starting. The victims' resources were just beginning. to get, you know, to get going. And there would be sometimes on television, there'd be a phone number, a hotline number that you could call. There was also a local hotline. And I remember I was very hesitant to call that because my sister-in-law was on it. Mm-hmm. So I didn't, you know, I didn't. And plus the fact, I never thought of myself as a victim. And one of the things that I've learned, because I have turned this into a volunteer at a crisis center in New Jersey, is that people who are victims never think of themselves as victims. You think of yourself, it's your life. And you just don't. And from whatever is going on in your head, you don't think of yourself as a victim. I never thought of myself as a victim. I never thought of myself as a battered wife. I never thought of myself as being abused. I thought it was my fault. And of course, if it's your fault, then you can do something about it. But I found out that no matter how hard I tried, there was nothing I could do about it. And one person can't save a marriage. It has to be two people who are willing to work at it.
You know, one thing that I do want to go back to a little bit, when you were being abused, this really broke my heart. You had a black eye and you went to work. Tell me that. Tell us that story.
Well, I was working in retail and I had the district. I was managing a convenience store, actually. And something happened the night before and I had a black eye. And I went to work, and there was nothing, I mean, I could not cover it up with makeup, although I did try, but there was nothing that I could do about it. So I just figured, well, I'm going to have to just bullet through. So I went to work, and when the district supervisor saw it, she actually wanted to fire me.
I can't believe this.
But again, there wasn't that much knowledge about battered women, about abuse or anything like that. And a lot of people, the attitude was, what did you do to deserve it? And the thing, fortunately for me, was that what happened was I had taken over this store and the sales had increased by $3,000 in the first 2 years I was there. So the people who owned the chain were not going to allow anybody to fire me because they were making, you know, I was doing good for them. Mm-hmm. And
that was a week, right? Per week?
Per week, yeah. A week, yeah. But that's I think, what saved me from being fired. But she thought that it was a bad image for the store. It probably was. But it's what happened.
So then at one point, then you went to see an attorney.
Oh,
only to be disappointed.
Oh, yes. I went to see an attorney. Actually, it was there was the convenience store. It was in a strip mall, and the attorney was in one of the offices upstairs. And I went to see him because I knew I had to do something. I knew I had to get out. And I went and I talked to him. And what he told me was, he said, you better go home and fix it because you can't afford a divorce. Mm-hmm. And I felt like I'd been sentenced back into hell.
You were.
I was. But again, when I started working at the convenience store, it wasn't because I really wanted to get a job. It was because my husband wanted me to earn money.
But by that time, you had moved to New Jersey.
We had moved to New Jersey. Mm-hmm. And basically, I felt like I was forced out of the house. I mean, I had six kids. I had a lot to do at home. I didn't need a job on top of it. But I finally, you know, just to shut them up, I got the job. And it was probably where my self-esteem started to return, because I got a lot of customers. And when the customers first started coming in, they were really nice and they always treated me really well. And it acted like they liked me. And I'd sit there and I'd go back in the office area and I'd think to myself, what's wrong with these people? Can't they see what I'm really like? Mm. Can't they see this awful person that I am? And Jerry keeps telling me how bad I am. And he really knows who I am, and they don't, and they can't see it. And I'm fooling everybody. And I'd go, there was a bathroom in the back and there was a mirror. And I'd go in and I'd say to myself, there's something wrong with them. What's wrong with them? But then it kept happening. And a little while later, I went back in and I thought, and I was saying to myself in the same mirror, maybe there's something here that I'm not seeing. And maybe they see something that I don't see and he doesn't. And so I thought, well, maybe I'll look at it like that. So I did for a little while. And in a little while, I went back into the They would come in to talk to me. They have their days off, and they'd come in looking for me to talk to me. And so finally, I went back in the same mirror, same bathroom, looked at myself, and I said, you know what? I'm going with the majority opinion. Good. And that's when my self-esteem started to return. It was only the start of it, but it started to return. And then after that, there was another incident. There was and remember, there was a girl who worked for me. She was really, really, she was really kooky, mm-hmm. but she was a really good friend. And she said to me, Mary Kay, she said, you need to call the battered women's shelter. And I said, because I was scared. I had six kids. I might have to do something. Mm-hmm. But anyway, she said, you're coming up to my apartment. I went up to the apartment and she took the phone off the wall. They were attached those days. She dialed a number and put it in my hand, and she said, talk to them. Huh. And I did. And I arranged to go to talk to somebody at the shelter. And, of course, nobody knows where the shelter is. I had to go to the police department. And then the police department told me where to go because they had to make sure that you weren't, you know, getting information for anybody who might have been living there. Mm-hmm. So it was very, very well protected. So I went, and I talked to this woman, and she recommended a book, and the book was called The Battered Wife. I don't remember the author's first name, but I know the last name was Wallace. I got that book. I went to the library, and they didn't have it at the library, but they did say that they could get it from another library for me. And I remember when I went to pick it up, the woman handed it to me, and she looked so sad. And I mean, I could see that there was a lot of empathy there. Mm-hmm. I couldn't take the book home. I took it to work, and I would read it when I'd have a little break or if there was time, you know, because if I took it home and he found it, I mean, it was going to be another big scene. So that opened my eyes to a lot of where I was coming from and what was going on with me and how I had gotten myself into this situation. And I also began to realize that it wasn't my fault.
But you really needed someone to take that phone and put it in your hand because you said you just needed someone to tell you what to do. You were helpless.
And it was a learned helplessness. I had been, like, there was somebody who told me what to do all my life. Mm-hmm. Now, my parents, God bless them, they did the best they can. But back when I was raised, your parents were the boss. And children did not make decisions for themselves. Parents made the decisions for you. And you just went ahead and did what they said because that's what they told you to do. I mean, I went to college because my mother told me I was going to go to college. I went to college and I went to Marywood because that's where they told me I was going to go. Home economics was a good field for a girl, so I majored in home economics. And that's just the way it was. So that it was a lifetime of being told and being, you know, being kind of, you know, geared into one thing. So I really rarely made a decision. And then I got married, and God help me if I tried to make a decision. You know, you didn't make a decision because it was a decision or a black eye. You'd choose to just keep your mouth shut mm-hmm. and, you know, just do whatever you had to do.
But something happened somewhere along the line one day where you finally got a restraining order. Where did that?
I did.
How'd that happen?
I remember we were going to church. This is how it started. I do remember we were going to church one Sunday morning. And my oldest daughter did not want to go to church because she didn't feel well. And she'd always been her father's favorite. But this morning, he got really angry at her. And he dragged her out of bed. Mm. And she got ready and she went with us. And at communion time, she just walked up to got communion and she walked out of the church. Mm-hmm. I didn't know where she was or where she was gone, and I was scared to death. Mm-hmm. She was 16 years old. And fortunately, that afternoon she called me and she said, don't tell him where I am, but I'm okay. I just want to make sure that you know where I am and that it's okay. And after that incident, I remember coming home from work and sitting in the driveway, and I said to God, if you know what I'm like, if you want me to get out of this marriage, you're going to have to do something to get me out of this marriage because you know what I'm like. I said, Lord, you're going to have to push me up the wall. You're going to have to push me across the ceiling, and you're going to have to push me down the other side because I am scared to death. Mm-hmm. And then I went in the house. And at some point, Morrissey did come home and everything. But I began at that point, I began to realize what I was doing to my kids. Like, it wasn't just me that was being affected. It was my children. Mm-hmm. And it was, someone said to me, what you won't do for yourself, you will do for your kids. And, you know, you're so involved with trying to just keep everything on an even keel. And all your energy is focused on not getting him angry that you don't notice what's going on around you. And at that point, I realized, my gosh, this is affecting the whole family. It's horrible. And I have to do something about this.
Let's find out what you did right after this quick little break. This is Make a Change with your host, Terry Martin, on 94.3 FM, The Talker.
Confidence. It's something we all search for. It's something we all strive for. When we're confident, we feel we can accomplish anything. I mean, think about it. When you knew you looked good, you walked with your head held a little higher. Looking people in the eye was easy. You felt like you could tackle the world. The first step in finding that confidence is obviously how you look. And when you look good on the outside, you feel good on the inside. Get that confidence you need with Mederi Clinicals. They are a unique skincare company that specializes in complete skincare for women and men. From anti-aging to glycolic and even a special clinical line for sensitive skin, Mederi Clinicals gives you that confidence. Make that change. Look brand new. Feel brand new with Mederi Clinicals. Check out MederiClinicals.com. That's M-E-D-E-R-I Clinicals.com or call 866-646-3374. Take on the world with Mederi Clinicals.
Welcome back to Make a Change on 94.3 FM, The Talker. My name is Tom Jenkins, along with your host, Terry Martin. And today's show, we have a special guest in the studio, Mary Kay. And she has been telling us more or less about, you know, how she was in an abusive marriage. And the thing that really stuck out to me the most, Mary Kay, is the fact that you didn't even realize you were a victim.
Right.
And I think that's very important that we get that out there, that, yeah.
That is abuse.
Yeah. And when we left off, finally, you know, you had said that little prayer, actually not a little prayer, but you begged God for help. And the words rang through your head that, you know, what you don't do for yourself, you do for your kids. And then where did you go from there?
Well, after that, we had been at my mother-in-law's for Easter dinner, which we always went there. And his whole family was there, his sisters and his brother, and the nieces and nephews. And they began talking, and somehow or another, something about, the conversation came to tempers. And my niece said, wow, she said, if you think that was, if his temper was bad, she said, I remember the time when my dad put his fist through a wall. And then my sister-in-law picked it up and she said, well, if you think that was bad, I remember the time when my father, now I don't remember what it was, that particular incident, what the father did, but what really got me is my mother-in-law then picked it up and she said, if you think that was bad, I remember the time when my father-in-law hit my mother-in-law over the head with a frozen loaf of bread. Like somebody took a pail of cold water and threw it on me. And it was like, the cycle has to stop. And it has to stop here. And it has to stop now. And it has to stop with me. There's nobody else to stop it. So we went home. And I knew I had to do something. I also knew that I needed an attorney. But this time, instead of going to the attorney upstairs in the office over where I worked, I called Battered Women's Shelter. And I asked them if they could give me any idea who would be a good attorney that they would recommend. Well, they actually don't recommend them, but they said they did have a list. So I chose one attorney. It was a woman. And it was the best choice I ever could have made because she knew exactly how to handle me. She knew exactly what I needed to do, and she told me what to do. And being the good little girl that I had always been, I did just exactly what I was supposed to. I had to get a restraining order, and it was a temporary restraining order. And I remember getting it, and I went to court. My oldest daughter came with me. She was there with me. She was like my rock. She was, I guess she was 17 at this point, and it was the day of her junior prom. But I had made arrangements with someone who worked for me to take, because the people that worked for me, they were like my family. And one of the girls who worked for me said, look, after the prom, tell her to come to my house. She can stay overnight. And then they were going to Great Adventure the next day. Of course, she had a date. She had a ride. So that was okay. But anyway, I got the restraining order. And I had to go home, and I wanted to get the kids out of the house because I knew the police were going to come and take their father out. Mm-hmm. So I got home, and I said, we were going over to my brother's in South Jersey. And so I said to the kids, you have to pack your bags because we're going to be going away for the weekend because your dad isn't going to be here after this weekend. So they were happy, mm-hmm. and they literally packed their bags, and they were paper bags. They put their clothes in them, and I had to get them out. I wanted to get them out as fast as I could, and we had this Datsun truck with a cap on the back, and that's what I drove that day. So the kids piled in the back of the truck, mm-hmm. and I got in the front, and I drove to work. And my brother met me at work. But of course, because I was very conscientious, I had to make sure that everything was okay at work before I went away for this whole weekend, because I was the manager after all, and I had to make sure that all the ducks were in a row. Mm-hmm. So I went there, and then from there we went to my brother's, and I spent that weekend, and I'll never forget the weekend. I was scared. I was a nervous wreck. And of all the things that bothered me more than anything is we lived on an acre and a half, and I didn't know how I was going to get the grass cut. But that was just, it was just trying to take my mind off something, other things. And I was thinking, oh, it's going to be so awful when we go back to the house. Nobody will be there. It'll be like this big hole. And we went back to the house, and I was in the house 5 minutes, and it was like somebody had removed a 20-ton boulder from my shoulders. It was like, thank God. Mm-hmm. And the kids were happy, and it was totally amazing. It was not what I expected to have happened. And then I went to the school, of course, and I had to tell them what had happened. And the school nurse came out, and she said to me, she said, oh, you did this? And she said, you have to know that you did the right thing. And I said, why is that? And she said, my son Dan, who was at the hangar, he was 9. She said, I saw him smile for the first time this morning. So I really knew that I had done the right thing. But then we had to go back and get the final restraining order. And it was very nerve-wracking. It was very nerve-wracking. But I had made a decision, and I wanted to go through with it. And we did go to court, and my attorney was fantastic. And we got the final restraining order. And then, of course, after that, I had to go through with the divorce. And we were divorced. And anyhow, the judge ordered the whole family into therapy, which was the best thing that could possibly have happened. My ex-husband was also expected to go to therapy. He went for a year and quit. The kids and I stayed. And it was the therapy that helped us cope with what we had to cope with. We didn't have much money, and it was tough. But the thing was, I found things inside myself that I didn't know were there. I amazed myself. I didn't know that I could make these decisions. I didn't know that I didn't realize how responsible I was. Mm-hmm. And it was a process. It was just step by step by step. And the kids were involved in the process as well. And they had, everything wasn't all peaches and roses and all that thing after that. Because with the 6 kids, there was emotional reaction on their part and my part and the whole thing. We had our tough times, but we were in a lot better shape than we had been previously. And I know my one daughter said to me, Mom, how come you're always so happy? And I said to her, my mom used to say, I felt sorry for myself because I had no shoes till I saw a man who had no feet. And I said, there's always somebody worse off than you are. We didn't have much money, but I always knew there was somebody worse off than we were. And we may have been financially strapped, but our lives weren't in danger. Mm-hmm. And there was a peace to that. And I would wake up in the morning, I remember, with the six kids, and I'd just say to the Holy Spirit, please, please, I can't do this alone. Please, just take care of it. Take care of me and take care of them, but mostly take care of them.
But speaking of the Holy Spirit, you said that you went to work one day and you got sick. And you were you in a meeting or something?
Oh, this is when
this is a really important part,
okay.
I think.
I was, yes, I was a cradle Catholic. And at this point, I had left it. I wasn't going to church. I never stopped praying, but I just wasn't going to church. And I had left retail at this point, and I was in an office. And I was in a meeting. And I think it was the day as the Holy Spirit punched me in the chest because there's a horrible, horrible pain in my chest. And I had to stop. I said, wait a minute. I said, please just wait a minute. I said, I have got to lay down and put my feet up. Otherwise, I'm going to faint. And I got on the floor and I put my feet up on a chair. And one of the managers came over and said to me, are you okay? Do you need to go to the hospital? And I said, yes, yes, I do. I need to go to the hospital. So they called the ambulance. They hauled me out and I was in pain. And I was thinking, oh my gosh, I'm having a heart attack, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, I got to the hospital and 15 minutes later, the pain disappeared. Mm-hmm. But the hospital wasn't letting me out that easily. I was in the emergency room and they insisted that I stay. Because, I mean, if it were up to me, I would have said, okay, I'm okay. Let me go home. They said, that's not going to happen. And of course, when you go to the hospital, one of the things they ask you is, what's your religion? And I said, I'm a Catholic. So I waited until they found me a room and they wanted to make sure that they did tests the next day. So the next morning, I know it was 7 a.m., a Roman collar showed up at my door. It was a priest whose name I don't even remember. And he said to me, do you want to receive communion? And I said, oh, I can't. I said, I've been away from the church for so long. I said, and I haven't been going to church. I haven't been, you know, like practicing my religion. I said, I've been praying, but I'm not. And he said to me, he talked to me and I told him things. It was like basically like going to confession. And he said to me, you know, your sins are all forgiven. Now, do you want to receive communion? And I said to him, oh, I really want to. I said, but can I? And he said, your sins are all forgiven. What do you think Jesus would do? Mm-hmm. And I said, okay. And I received communion. And then I had wanted to get back to the church, but I hadn't gotten an annulment. And I felt bad about it. And I was married outside the church at this point. I think I'd been married for almost a year. And so I started going to this parish that was close to the house. And I would sit in the back so nobody noticed me. But I should have realized it was a round church. So there's no place you could sit. You couldn't be noticed. But anyhow, one day it was after Mass. And I was going to daily Mass because I was working like an afternoon from 4 till midnight. And I would go. And the priest, I would say and I would pray. And the priest came over to me and he said to me, I want you to say a prayer for my intention. Oh, and before that, part of the prayer was, if you want me to get this straightened out, could you have that priest come over and talk to me? And within 30 seconds, wow, he came over to me and he said, I want you to pray for me for an intention. And I said, for a special intention for me. And I said, okay. And then he started to walk away. I said, wait a minute, come back. And he came back and I told him what the story was. And he said, okay, he said, you want to have the marriage blessed in the church? And I said, oh, I said, that would be the most wonderful thing that could happen. And he said, great. He said, call, make an appointment, and come and see me on Monday. And he said, your husband knows what you're up to, doesn't he? I said, yes, he knows what I'm up to. So
you mean your new husband?
My new husband.
Which you were
my new husband.
Finally had a good marriage.
After 9 years, my new husband. And but anyhow, we went and we talked to him and everything, and then we were, God bless Father Jude was his name, is his name. He made sure that we wouldn't have two anniversaries to celebrate. So 1 year from the day that we were married in my son-in-law's backyard, we were married in that parish by Father Jude. And it was like, people say to me, well, how long have you been married? I said, well, if you're Protestant, I'm married for 17 years. If you're Catholic, 16. So but it was the same day. So it was, you know, it was just such a relief. And I my religion meant so much to me. And the first thing I said to Father after we were married, I said, you know, Father, I know you need an eighth grade teacher for the religious ed class. I said, if you still don't have one, I'll do it. So that's how I started getting involved.
Led you to actually being full of confidence to give all the talks that you give.
Yeah.
For tithing, right?
Yeah, it led me to this area where Father would call and he'd ask me to do things, and I'd of course say yes. And I used to laugh and say, I can never say no to Father Jude, but I would do it because I really wanted to. And then at one point we had this McKenna tithing or McKenna stewardship group come in, and they talked about tithing, and part of that program was time and talent. And Father asked me if I would run the time and talent portion of it for the parish, and I did. And I had some, you know, like basic information, but then I formulated my own little, you know, scenario. And after I did, they asked for a report to be written, and I wrote the report, and they were using that as the national model for the time and talent. So that was pretty neat. And shortly after that, the man who was in charge of it, who was a business professor at Seton Hall, asked me if I would consider doing tithing talks. And I told him I would. And I've been doing that now for quite a few years. And we're invited to go. And then we go in and we talk. We tell what our experiences were with tithing. That's all.
We're going to take one more break. When we come back, I want to hear everything about what's going on in your life today. all of the good stuff.
Right, where this brought you to.
All of the good stuff. This is Make a Change with your host, Terry Martin. I'm Tom Jenkins. Our special guest today, Mary Kay Hitzel Martin. How would you? Just Mary Kay.
Mary Kay is good.
And we will be right back on 94.3 FM, The Talker. Confidence. It's something we all search for. It's something we all strive for. When we're confident, we feel we can accomplish anything. I mean, think about it. When you knew you looked good, you walked with your head held a little higher. Looking people in the eye was easy. You felt like you could tackle the world. The first step in finding that confidence is obviously how you look. And when you look good on the outside, you feel good on the inside. Get that confidence you need with Mederi Clinicals. They are a unique skincare company that specializes in complete skincare for women and men. From anti-aging to glycolic and even a special clinical line for sensitive skin, Mederi Clinicals gives you that confidence. Make that change. Look brand new. Feel brand new with Mederi Clinicals. Check out MederiClinicals.com. That's MederiClinicals.com. Or call 866-646-3374. Take on the world with Mederi Clinicals. And we're back on Make a Change on 94.3 FM, The Talker. My name is Tom Jenkins, along with your host, Terry Martin. Our special guest in the studio today is Mary Kay, all the way from New Jersey. Thank you again for making the trek back to your homestead of Scranton, PA. And the story we have heard, if you have not listened, make sure you go to Terry's webpage, MederiClinicals.com, and listen to this show from the beginning. Mary Kay, what you have been through, God bless you. I'm kind of speechless on it. What I find fascinating, though, is that how all of this growth and this change in your life started just with stranger customers at a convenient mart.
Right.
You know, that kind of fascinated me. And what you have become today, you know, a lot of us, when we go through traumatic times in our lives, or, you know, drug addiction, alcohol addiction, abusive relationships, whatever the case may be, so many of us, the automatic human reaction is to get through it and then put it behind us and leave it there.
Right.
And here you are, how many years later, coming back here and not leaving it behind you. You're rehashing it, not to rehash it, but for a reason to use it to hopefully help other people.
Yes, for the good.
Using others' evil's powers for your good.
Yeah.
If you want to look at it that way. Not to make light of it, but I mean, that's what's going on in your life today? What are you doing today with all of that experience that you've been through in the past?
Well, with all the experience I had in the past, I didn't want to just leave it there. I've learned an awful lot, and I want to be able to pass on some of what I've learned and hopefully help some other people. Right now, I am a volunteer at the Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault Crisis Center. One of the main things I do is I'm a legal advocate, and I go to court where we basically supply information for the young ladies and sometimes older women who are trying to get out of their abusive relationship. We want them to know that there is help out there, and we want them to know what kind of help there is. There's free counseling that's available. There's a 24/7 hotline. We help them make a safety plan. And some of the women decide not to go through with the restraining order. And that, when that happens, that hurts my heart. But at least we can provide them with the information that they need so that they can do things to protect themselves, and that they can, if they come to the conclusion that they actually want to leave the relationship, they have the resources. They have the tools that they can use to get themselves out. Nobody can do it for you. You have to do it for yourself, but you also have to know where you can go for help. And this, to me, is like the most important thing to get the information out there. And the other thing I'm doing is I'm putting together a nutrition program to help the women who are at the shelter, because they're going to be in the situation where they're not going to have a whole lot of money, and they're going to have to feed their families, and they're going to have to do it nutritionally. So I haven't implemented that yet. I'm still in the process of formulating it, but hopefully come fall I'll be able to do that too. So, because I know, I mean, I had to feed my family on a shoestring, and you have to know how to stretch your money. One of the things is I know 101 ways to fix hamburger. You know, hamburger and stew meat and chicken. They were the staples.
But on top of all of this, you have lost almost 100 pounds.
Yes, I have.
This last year.
Mm-hmm.
And why don't you explain how you did that and what you're doing with that now?
Okay.
Because your confidence finally got high enough after all these years
to do it. My confidence has been coming back gradually. It's been coming back gradually for about 20 years. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you just always find a little more as you go along. Well, I had some health problems. I had diabetes, and I have a hypo or underactive thyroid. And I had been going to the doctor, and a friend of mine from church, I kept seeing her, and she kept looking better and better all the time. And I asked her what she had done, or, you know, I didn't want to be nosy, but she looked fantastic, and I really wanted to know how she managed to do this. Mm-hmm. I thought there might be some kind of a miracle out there. Mm-hmm. So she told me that she had bariatric surgery. And I said, oh, I said, that's very interesting. I said, I gave some thought to that. I said, but I don't think I'm a candidate for it. And so I told her a little bit about what was going on. She said, maybe you might want to look into it. So it was about 2 weeks after that, that there was a brochure that came out from the hospital, and it had a seminar and an information session about bariatric surgery. So I went to that, and I was very afraid of it, but the doctors had a 100% survival rate, so I wasn't too worried about, you know, the dying part. At any rate, I made an appointment just to go and talk to the doctors, and I went and I started. When I started looking into it, I realized that what I had been told was that I was metabolic resistant, which means I couldn't lose weight no matter what I did. I was doing everything in my power, and I used to say, if I only gain 0.5 pound a week, I consider myself lucky, and that is if I stay very close to my eating plan and don't deviate from it at all. So I did make the decision that I would go ahead and do it. And that was on October 14th, to be precise. Mm-hmm. I had the surgery. And what happened was, it's called a sleeve. And my stomach has been reduced to 15% of its former from its former glory. At any rate, and they explained to you very clearly that this is a tool, that what you have a problem. And the eating and the fat, they're only a symptom of things that are deeper inside, and it's your head you have to change.
Mm-hmm.
And for a while you can't eat nearly what you used to eat, but there is a point where your appetite comes back, and it's the appetite that you have to really deal with. So starting in September, matter of fact, September 16th, I'm beginning a support group for pre and post bariatric patients, so that we can work on what we need to work on to keep the weight off and not gain it back. I know there are some people who have had the surgery and have actually gained it back, and they're also very welcome to come to the program, because they had it when it first started, like it was in 2000, and there wasn't, again, there weren't the resources, there wasn't the knowledge. They were almost like the experimental group. So now that we know more, so it's going to be a support self-help group.
And you're healthier now because if you didn't do something, you were going to be in really serious trouble. But now even your diabetes, you don't even have to do anything with?
I don't have to do anything with it. I say it's in remission, but it's not there anymore. Mm-hmm. I don't have to stick my finger every morning and find out what the glucose reading is or anything like that. My doctor did say it might not be a bad idea to do it once or twice a week if you want to, and I do, but it's way down in the normal range. I started an exercise program, and I was too big, and it was very uncomfortable to exercise, so I didn't. But
you were exhausted even.
I was. And I am, believe me, every chance I get, I'm on that treadmill and I'm walking. I'm up to 4 miles. I'm up to 4 miles every time I do it, which I can't say I do it every day, but I do try to do it every day. But sometimes life interferes.
But I love what you said, that you feel like you're 25 years old.
Oh, yeah.
Again.
I told you, I graduated in 1961, so you can figure out how old I am. And I do. I feel better than I did when I was 25 years old. And these are all the good things that came out as a result of this. Mm-hmm. And it can be done. And I'm amazed. I tell my story and people say, oh, wow, how did you do it? And I think, I have no idea how I did it. But I can tell you, I mean, at the time, I wouldn't have known how I did it, but it was my life. I did it one step at a time. Mm-hmm. And I prayed. And I prayed and I prayed, and it was God that got me through. I wouldn't be able to be here today if it weren't for my prayer life and my spirituality, and the fact that this is where my life is. This is the most important part of my life. The most important part is the spirituality, and then after that comes the other things. But once you do this, once you get the spiritual straightened out, and you know that you can depend on God and that He is taking care of you, the rest of it comes.
Well, what amazes me is watching you, the strength that you do have, but you would think at this time of your life, after it's been so hard all along, it's time you could relax and take it easy. But instead, you're out there busier than ever trying to help so many people, not only in the Victims Resource Center, but with their weight loss, and now you're making up this whole new program. And I know that I heard you say in the past that even some of these young ladies, they really don't even know how to cook. And you're going beyond the victim's resource part. You're actually trying to teach them how to eat right. It's amazing. You do a lot.
It's just what I do. It's what I need to do. I need to give back. I need to at least, even if it's only one person that gets helped by something I've been through or anything that I do now, that it's just one person. I have a need to give back. I absolutely need to do what I do. I couldn't be happy with myself if I didn't.
Well, I know we're really happy that you came back to Scranton. I mean, Scranton. I
have to say that. Before we wrap up, what did we forget? What is there one last thing that you would like to get out?
Well, I want to say that my second marriage is absolutely fantastic and happy and wonderful. And the man I married is like the best thing that ever happened to me in my life. And I frequently tell him that he is my reward for every single thing I've been through in my life. He treats me better than anybody ever did. And I am grateful to God that He brought him into my life.
Beautiful. Well, thank you so much for coming in today.
Thank you for having me.
It was very inspirational. And of course, if you would like to hear the show from the beginning, you want to get a copy of this, I strongly recommend it. You can go to MederiClinicals.com. That's Terry Martin's webpage there. Also, all of her wonderful products are there as well. You can give Terry a call if you'd like at 570-575-8185. And this is Make a Change. I'm Tom Jenkins, your host, Terry Martin.
Thank you.
And our special guest today, Mary Kay Hitzel Martin.
Thank you.
Mary Kay, thank you again. And thank you so much for listening to Make a Change on 94.3 FM, The Talker. Have a great weekend.
Confidence. It's something we all search for. It's something we all strive for. When we're confident, we feel we can accomplish anything. I mean, think about it. When you knew you looked good,
You walked with your head held a little higher. Looking people in the eye was easy. You felt like you could tackle the world. The first step in finding that confidence is obviously how you look. And when you look good on the outside, you feel good on the inside. Get that confidence you need with Mederi Clinicals. They are a unique skincare company that specializes in complete skincare for women and men. From anti-aging to glycolic and even a special clinical line for sensitive skin, Mederi Clinicals gives you that confidence. Make that change. Look brand new. Feel brand new with Mederi Clinicals. Check out MederiClinicals.com. That's M-E-D-E-R-I Clinicals.com or call 866-646-3374. Take on the world with Mederi Clinicals.